I assume most of you are PhD students, researchers of some sort. You've got some background. Yeah?
Master's
student. Okay, cool, cool. And you've probably read a little bit of Deleuze and maybe some other Western philosophy?
Foucault.
Foucault, okay. But have you read classics? Have you read like Plato and Aristotle and Socrates? Okay, all right. If I say Socrates, it won't come as a surprise. People will know. Okay. The reason I like to start with Hegel for explaining Deleuze, and this is not the way a lot of people start. Deleuze, among other things, was a student of Hippolyte. Hippolyte was the first translator of Hegel's Phenomenology of Spirit into French and wrote some very important commentaries on Hegel's phenomenology and on other texts. And Deleuze, who is oftentimes seen as a bad reader of Hegel because of some very polemical things that he has to say, especially in his book on Nietzsche, many people don't realize just how closely his work is related to Hippolyte's reading of Hegel and kind of the way Deleuze tries to plot a course away from that, as well as other figures in the history of Western philosophy. So I'll talk at you quite a bit today about Hegel, as well as the background to Hegel's thought. Deleuze, when he, in his opening to Difference and Repetition, he speaks of that work and others as being part of a generalized anti-Hegelianism in France in the 1960s. So, you know, he does occasionally make the point that, you know, his work is directed, among other things, at Hegel as a key figure. And also, it's a good way to kind of understand when you hear Deleuze is an anti-dialectician, for example, what exactly that means, why he's opposed to the dialectic, why he's opposed to Hegelian ideas of identity, and so forth, and what the consequences are of that. So first day will be Hegel, then we'll look at Nietzsche, but really Deleuze's reading of Nietzsche. And you know, many people would refer to Deleuze's reading of Bergson as kind of his key, Bergson as his key figure, but I tend to think it's more Nietzsche and Leibniz and a few other figures like that, and it makes a good counterpoint to the Hegel, because although Hegel is present in Deleuze's reading of Bergson and others, it's kind of that's his most polemical text against Hegel, but also in many ways his most subtle critique of Hegel, and it'll follow on from what we're just going to discuss today. Then I'll try and take you through very briefly Deleuze's theories of difference and time, primarily from Difference and Repetition, the first two chapters, and then we'll look at anti-Oedipus, and we'll get into some Lacan and the anti-Lacanian side of that, and then we'll look at some of the stuff in A Thousand Plateaus related to questions of politics, the idea of many of multiple levels of politics, of micropolitics, of lines of flight, possibly bodies without organs, and so on. And one of the things I think I will do at the end is kind of relate it back to Hegel's philosophy of right, and kind of looking at Hegel's philosophy of right, his theory of the state in relation to Deleuze's theory of the war machine as a thing that is exterior to the state machinery, the state apparatus. Okay? I don't really intend to conduct these as lectures as such. I am really good at talking. It's probably something that comes from being born and raised in the United States. We know how to talk. We know how to talk really loud. I don't really need this microphone, but I probably have enough of an ego to like the sound of my own voice. But you're more than welcome, if you have questions, to just raise your hands. Just, you know, there's no particular. I don't have to. You know, I can stop at any point if you're lost, if you need me to explain something, and so on. Don't ask me questions that get me off the story. Don't ask me questions that will be about something that is down the road. If you do ask me, I'll just tell you, don't get me off the story. That's for a later chapter. Okay? So we'll start with Hegel, but before we start with Hegel, we'll start with some background figures. And some of the things that I'll be discussing today are also, you know, Deleuze references as well in his discussions of Plato and Difference and Repetition, his discussions of Aristotle. So we'll go through some of those things which relate in one level to Hegel, but also will relate. So I won't have to repeat them in a couple of days' time when we discuss Deleuze on Plato or Deleuze on Aristotle. All right? Western philosophy starts with the pre-Socratics, but we don't really pay as much attention to them because we say it starts with Socrates. And you all know who Socrates is, I suppose. You've heard of him. In a very good movie that was around when I was a kid called Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, they keep referring to him as Socrates. Yeah. but Socrates. Right? We know who he is, teacher of Plato, who is the teacher of Aristotle. Socrates is a figure who is known for going around the marketplace of Athens and asking questions. And Deleuze himself makes reference to this. There's always this question about the form of the question that Socrates asks. And is Socrates even asking very fair questions? What is the way in which he asks the questions, which kind of begins a certain kind of philosophy that is very dear to Plato, a separation between essence and appearance, and a certain kind of attitude towards truth, and a certain metaphysics about the structure of the world. Does anybody know about the kinds of questions Socrates will normally ask people? Yeah. They always take the form of what is X? What is justice? What is courage? What is beauty? What is X? Right? And the people that Socrates asks these questions to sometimes are children, sometimes are politicians, sometimes are various other figures on the street. Oftentimes they are sophists. They are the people that Socrates is pitted against. They're the people who also put Socrates on trial at the end of his life when Socrates defends himself in one of Plato's dialogues called the Apology. Apology doesn't mean I'm sorry, it means a defense. So the sophists are teachers of rhetoric. Right? This is in Athens in the 4th century BC. Athens is a democracy, by which it means that adult male citizens are able to participate directly in politics and make decisions. It means that women aren't, children aren't, slaves are not allowed, foreigners are not allowed, foreigners are known as medics. They don't get to participate. So democracy means this actually relatively small number of the population, which make often direct democratic decisions. They vote directly on matters, on various matters. They also serve on things like juries and like they take they're selected at random to take various offices as well, and so on. The sophists are these teachers of rhetoric, because in the assembly where everyone in Athens gathers to debate and hear arguments, the sophists teach you how to speak to the crowd. They teach you how to make an argument in the form of appealing to the audience. Right? So they're teachers of rhetoric. They're teachers of how to speak well. And sophist comes from Sophia, to the goddess of wisdom. The sophist, but Socrates says he's not a sophist, he's accused of being a sophist, but he calls himself a philosopher, philosophia, a lover of wisdom. Right? Philosophy is supposed to be a lover, a friend of wisdom. The sophists, according to Socrates, peddle a false wisdom. Right? Because they don't tell you the truth, they tell you how to manipulate a crowd, how to appeal to a crowd. Right? So Socrates does battle with them, as well as many others, by going around and asking questions. And again, it's the form of the question that's really at issue. What is X? What is beauty? And Socrates will ask, and invariably, because Socrates himself didn't write anything, so it's Plato's dialogues where we get Socrates' voice, or sometimes we get Plato's voice spoken through Socrates. There's a couple of dialogues where Socrates is just in the sidelines, and the law, I think he's not even there at all. But Socrates will ask the question, what is beauty? And his interlocutors will answer with an example. They'll say that beauty is a horse or a flower or a young virgin or a young boy. And Socrates will say, that wasn't an answer to my question. I didn't ask you to give me an example of what is beauty. I asked you, what is beauty? And Socrates will press home this point. There's a few of the dialogues. I think it's Greater Hippias is one where they say, Socrates, this isn't even really the appropriate question to ask, but Socrates manages to get away with this question all the time, in part because Plato writes the dialogues so that Socrates gets away with this pretty much all the time. Some of the dialogues are great because they're not dialogues at all. The Republic, the first book of the Republic out of 10 books is dialogue. Socrates has arguments back and forth, and books 2 through 10, Socrates is waxes on, and everyone sort of nods their heads. They ask questions so that we can kind of move to the next point and so forth. All right? So what does all that mean? Socrates, if the answer to the question is wrong, because you can't answer a question, what is beauty, with an answer, well, what is the answer? In the early dialogues, what are classified as the early dialogues, Socrates doesn't usually give you the answer. They're aporetic. They kind of end in a blockage. And oftentimes Socrates will say, we have to go back and start the discussion over, and then whoever he's discussing things with gets kind of sick of it and goes away. It's erythro, I'm probably mispronouncing that, where the interlocutor says, you know, Socrates, I have to go. They're going to put you on trial shortly. It's the indication he's going to be put on trial. But in the middle dialogues in particular, the Republic, Socrates does give an answer. Plato gives an answer. And although Plato then in some ways moves away from the answer, in some ways you could say he starts to discuss the conditions under which the answer makes any sense. The Republic probably is kind of the answer, is the text everyone reads which gives you the answer. Step up here. Beauty. Plato will say, is a form that is nothing but the beautiful, right? This is beauty in itself. It's something universal. It's unchanging. And it serves as a kind of truth, as well as a kind of identity, because it's unchanging, right? And different things, there's a gap here that's very important. Different things are more or less beautiful to the extent to which they correspond to the form, to which they reflect it, mirror it, copy it, and so forth. So we'll make it a tie. You can decide for yourself whether you prefer virgins or boys. If you can't get any of them, maybe they're horses. And if you're rejected by the horses, you're going to edit this out, right? There's always the flowers. They'll never reject you. You can at least look at them. All right? Things that are more or less beautiful insofar as they embody the form. All right? Now, by the way, there are only forms of positive things. There's only forms of goodness, of justice, of beauty. There's no form of ugliness. Right? There's no positive embodiment of the ugly. The ugly is just that which falls furthest away from the beautiful. So there's a notion of lack. Right? That going down here, this has less beauty than horses, less beauty than virgins and boys, so forth. All right? And again, this is unchanging, universal. This realm, Socrates will say, and I'll add here, this is a realm of being, of that which is. This is the physical world, the realm of becoming, right? That which changes. And all of these things, they're not just more or less beautiful permanently. It depends on time and place, all right? So all of these things become and change. They can be more beautiful. They can be less beautiful, all right? In the dark, none of them are beautiful. None of them are ugly because you can't see them, all right? But beauty is beauty regardless of time and place. Beautiful things, context matters. And that's going to be, as Deleuze says in the Nietzsche book, the distinction that Plato loves to play with, the essence versus the appearance, or what is unchanging versus what changes. All right. This serves as a truth for making judgments about these. And you know, Socrates says in his apology, he talks about he's a critic of Athenian democracy, not because he thinks that there's something wrong with democracy as such. But he says that democracy cannot be, democracy requires that people have knowledge, right? So how can you discuss political things? How can you discuss justice, for example, if you don't know what justice is? So Socrates himself, in the early dialogues at least, talks about how if people simply start to discuss and learn what the truth is, then they can be made fit for politics. Plato's different. Plato talks about only certain people called philosophers really are fit to rule because they have a knowledge of what's unchanging. But here's the thing. Knowledge is what is unchanging, right? And that's firms as the foundation for any judgments that you might make about things that do change. Okay? Make sense? Excellent. Now, where do we go? Yeah, I'll erase it. So we've got this distinction between the forms and physical things. This is going to be one of the things Hegel wants to overcome, by the way. So there's Hegel will reject this, and one of the ways in which he rejects this is going to set the stage for all this post-Hegelian philosophy as well. Let's, yeah, sorry. Beauty was a form or an idea. That's, yeah. Sorry, what do you mean? How can an idea be a form?
He's saying that this is a form.
Yeah.
And there are replicas in the physical world.
Right.
Why is he calling it form?
The Greek is idei, right? It's often translated as idea. I tend to use form, which may or may not be. That's a good way of explaining it. In a way, it's because the form is what will be graspable by the intellect. Okay? So these things, which have an embodiment of form, they're physical things, they're material things, there'll be an idea that what you can know about them, what you can conceptualize about them, is their form as opposed to their materiality. Does that make a bit of sense? Okay. So matter is going to be this thing that's unknowable as such unless it is formed. Because the form gives, I mean, a different way of thinking about it, and this is what Aristotle will say about form, is it's the definition of something. So form is what defines a thing, the form that it assumes. And that means it can be defined, it can be intellectualized, it can be understood. So, yeah, that's the connection between form and idea. So,
is it close to, is it quite related to Plato's ideal type?
Yeah. You mean beauty?
Beauty, yeah.
Yeah, is an ideal type.
It's an ideal type.
Yeah.
So he kind of prescribes ideal type because they favor perfectionism of a form.
Yeah, I don't know if it's right to say because he favors perfectionism, but that's what's embodied in this division. Yeah. I mean, there's actually something else I shouldn't have quite deleted it yet.
The form is what we can access, and the substance is what we cannot access.
The material is what we can grasp, cannot grasp intellectually. Yeah. So then this comes to actually something else. Da-da-da-da-da. Okay. One of the consequences of this, and maybe this will also help explain. Because there's this gap, that's going to be really crucial. No thing, no physical thing, no thing that changes, no matter how beautiful, can be beauty itself. Right? So whoever you think is the most beautiful, whatever you think is the most beautiful thing, no physical thing can be beauty as such. Because this is beauty for all times and places. Now that will have a consequence in terms of how we have knowledge, right? Because Socrates says, or Plato says, you need to have knowledge of the forms to have knowledge and to make judgments, right? The thing about the Sophists don't know what beauty is. They simply try and appeal to a crowd to say, this is beautiful, she's beautiful, he's beautiful, all right? And Socrates will say, that's not giving you knowledge, that's kind of manipulating you in your lack of knowledge to judge things one way versus another way. All right? An example, a kind of cruel example that I like to give, at least to my students. She's been around now for a few decades. She was very popular in the 80s. She kind of disappeared in the 90s. She reappeared in the 2000s. All right? Did Kylie Minogue make it to India?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
How many people are absolutely certain that Kylie Minogue is beautiful? Very few people. She's well marketed. Everyone knows she's well marketed, and one of the things is she beautiful or is she just well marketed? All right. Beauty, by the way, is in the eye of the beholder, so she's beautiful if you think she's beautiful. But you get the difference, right? Socrates, Plato will say, beauty, you have to know what this unchanging thing is. Everybody else is just manipulating. Alright? Now, that has a certain understanding, that entails a certain kind of understanding of truth, that is, of the philosopher's favored understanding of truth, alright? And the philosopher's favored understanding of knowledge. If there is no form up here, and that's going to be one of the things that Deleuze will say, one of the things that Nietzsche will say, this is a problem. Nietzsche will say this is a problem of our grammar. is from the fact that we can take a quality like beauty and turn it into a substantive. Right? The reality, Nietzsche would say, others would say, there's no such thing as beauty as an unchanging form, there's just beautiful things. It's a quality that attaches to things in the world. All right, we haven't defined what it is yet. But just like there's no such thing as whiteness, there are just different kinds of white that you see in the world, and whiteness is just an abstraction of that. All right? It's taking this white and this white and the white of the paper, all right, and kind of holding an idea, again, in your head, of what those different things share in common. It's an abstraction, which we'll get back to later as well. All right? But if there's no such thing as beauty, then is beauty something, you know, as a separate form, is beauty something that philosophers know, or is it something that hairdressers and makeup artists know? All right? You know, and that's a different, that's a kind of knowledge too. That's a knowledge that's much more contextual, that's much more cultural. All right? You know, what is the style of the day? All right? My wife is Chinese, all right? And so I know this from her and others. You could go to Tony and Guy. Did Tony and Guy make it to India? Big hair salon chain, right? You know, where everyone is very well trained and probably not very well paid. You still have to find the right people who know how to cut thick, straight Asian hair. So having, you know, some of them have the knowledge to do that and some of them don't. All right? In the West, at least, they have something called makeovers. Sometimes you can get these done for free. You can go to a place, they'll give you a makeover, they'll put tons of makeup on your face, they'll put, you know, do your hair up, they'll put you in front of a camera, they'll take a whole bunch of pictures, and then they'll try and make you buy the pictures for an exorbitant amount of money. So it's free, but then they want you, you know, this is how beautiful you can look if you take the if you buy the pictures. All right? Many people have the makeover. They get, it's obviously oftentimes more women than men, they get very disconcerted by the amount of makeup that's put on them. There's layers and layers and layers. The reason for that is because they're then put under really bright lights, and their features can just all wash out with that light if there's not enough makeup on. So it's very, very unnatural. Like people who kind of put on a bit of makeup can't really handle. But you know, if you go on stage, if you've done anything like that, you know how much makeup you need to wear, and they put on tons and tons of makeup. Anyway, that side point does have relevance to Deleuze, as we will see. Let's get back to this. Again, no physical thing, no matter how beautiful, according to Plato, would be beauty itself, which is why, and this is one of the things Plato will insist upon, you cannot know what beauty is by seeing beautiful things. Right? Which is very different from what Aristotle will say, that you know, you learn what things are by some form of experience. Socrates, Plato will say, you learn what beauty is through a kind of contemplation. So the idea of the philosopher as the contemplative one, who looks inside himself, who finds out what beauty is by having an access to the form, right? That idea is, knowledge comes from turning away from the physical world. The physical world is the source of error. Our senses are a source of error, right? So let's go on. So this idea of the form and physical things and the differences between them, in the Republic, I always forget which book it is, whether it's 5 or 6. Anyway, we can look this up later. A question arises, how does one know the forms? Right? Because I've already mentioned the forms you don't learn by looking out at the world. There's some way in which you look inside yourself. Part of Plato's argument for the immortality of the soul is based on the idea that since the soul could not get knowledge of the forms from the world, it must have had knowledge before it became embodied. So the soul must have had direct access to the forms, and the forms are somehow, there's a trace of them in the soul. If the soul can kind of shut out the physical world and look inside itself, it can see, it can grasp them. All right? So we know what we need to kind of, where we need to be oriented to have knowledge. It's within ourselves, but the question then is, how do you grasp the forms or the ideas? There's this discussion in the Republic, what is knowledge like? It's based on analogy. And the discussion is, knowledge could be like hearing, it could be like touching, or it could be like seeing. And Socrates will say, it's like seeing. And everyone says, yes, Socrates, it is. And there's a significance to this, because to feel something, you need two things. You need your hand to work, you need the object that you're touching. To hear something, you need your ears to work, and you need there to be a sound, right? It travels through the atmosphere and vibrates against your ear, right? But to see something, you need three things. You need your eyes to work, you need the object like this dry marker to see, and you need a light. And that's the key thing. Knowledge is like seeing, means that knowledge requires a medium, right? So to grasp the forms or the ideas, to know them, is to see them. So you have to look into your soul and see their imprint, right? That requires a light. Plato will construct what he calls his divided line precisely from that idea, right? The divided line is the idea that the forms require a light to illuminate them, which Plato will then refer to as the form of the forms, or the good. And Plato is, in fact, asked to describe it. He says he can't describe it. He will describe the things that are closest to it. So you end up with this thing called the divided line, which you might know about. Forms, or we can go with ideas. These are mathematical objects, physical objects, and art, illusions, or a word that Deleuze will use, simulations or simulacra. All right, that's wider there. This is the realm of being, of things that, you know, do not change, the good as well. This is the realm of becoming. All right? And these are supposed to reflect or copy these, supposed to reflect or copy this. So the good, Plato compares to the sun, and when asked to describe it, he says he can't. He will describe what's closest to it. These unchanging forms are ideas, which are what the philosopher aims to know. Mathematical objects can also be known, and they're perfect as well, all right? So there are physical things which are triangular, but there's no perfect triangles in the physical world. You know, it's absolute, you know, dimensionless, you know, lines with no thickness, right? Well, one-dimensional, perfect angles and so forth. That can only be conceptualized, all right? But mathematical objects are still pictorial. So even if you contemplate the perfect triangle, there's still a pictorial aspect to that. So they're not as perfect as other forms, Plato would say. Right? And then, you know, that's why the education of the philosopher before philosophy itself, the study of the forms, is the study of mathematics and geometry. But then there are physical things that are copies or embodiments of the forms. So there are triangular things that are embodiments of triangles, but there are other things that are just. There are forms of man, which human beings embody, and so forth. Then there's artwork or illusions or simulations. And Plato will define these as copies of copies. All right? And they'll have a reality that is comparable, that fits that. Right? So one example given in the last book of the Republic is a bed, all right, made by a craftsman. There's a form of the bed, or an idea of what a bed is. There's a physical bed, which is the one you sleep in, and it's either a good bed or a bad bed, depending on how well it accommodates the idea of a bed as being, you know, something comfortable to lie down and to sleep in, and so forth. And then there's a painting of a bed, right, which has a lower level of reality. It's a copy three times removed, Plato will say, because these are copies, he will say, of the good. So forth. So you have this divided line, you have this hierarchy of what changes, what doesn't change, where truth is to be found, where it isn't to be found. This is the realm also of knowledge. Knowledge and wisdom is knowledge of the forms. This is the realm of opinion. We have an opinion about whether Kylie is beautiful or not. Opinions, when not manipulated, still have some connection to knowledge, because you can't really have an opinion if you don't know anything, Socrates will say. But this is the realm of illusion, is the realm of sophistry, of manipulation. The sophists don't even give you opinions, they manipulate you into thinking something's beautiful that is, you know, without any knowledge. And that's the way Socrates will try and say in the Republic, philosophers are up here, sophists are down there. The sophist, and Socrates will be accused of being a sophist. As I said, Deleuze will make the point, that Socrates never escapes the charge of being a sophist. He's accused of being a sophist even at his trial, right? And indeed, if you read the dialogue, The Sophist, which Deleuze likes to reference in both Difference and Repetition and The Logic of Sense, he talks about how the dialogue of The Sophist is trying to define The Sophist, trying to give you what the idea or the form of The Sophist is, which is a paradoxical task. And it ends up being a definition of The Sophist, which is basically the same thing as Socrates. And that's one where Socrates is present, but he's off to the side. He doesn't participate in the discussion. It's a boy and just a stranger. And they're just sitting going back and forth, and the stranger says at the end, the sophist is a person who uses irony in arguments and private means, etc. He describes what Socrates does. All right? So that's one of the problems. Okay? There are two main problems with this divided line, which we will get to shortly. Oh, one quick thing. Side point. If you take out one of those O's, you have this. The Augustine, who was a 4th century, 3rd century, 4th, yeah, 4th century, 380 something, is when the City of God is written. Sorry, 5th century. St. Augustine, who is one of the founding church fathers, Christian church fathers, spent his young adult life, among other things, being neurotic and constantly afraid of dying and constantly afraid of what would happen after his death. And he was born to a Christian mother and a pagan father, and he wasn't really religious. He found himself bouncing from religion to religion, from religious sect to religious sect, including he spent some time being a Manichaean, which was a Gnostic a sect, which, you know, borrowed from both the Old and New Testaments, as well as I think other religions from the East, which came up with an idea that there were two gods, right, a good god and an evil god. Anyway, so Augustine eventually becomes a Christian, but the last thing he is before he's a Christian is he's a Platonist, and he says that Plato's idea of the divided line and of the good and of the Trinity, the idea that because this thing which is the good is also being and is also unity. Right, there's a trinity of amongst the Neoplatonists of the good, the one, and being. He says that that's the closest that the non-Christians ever came to discovering the truth of Christianity. Right, and he even suggests that Plato, insofar as Plato stumbles upon the truth of Christianity, he must have plagiarized from the Bible. There's this idea that there's this apocryphal story that Plato spent time in Egypt in the Old Testament, which was in Hebrew at the time. He met somebody who translated the Old Testament, read it to him in Greek, and that's where he got his idea of the divided line and the good. And so Plato was a plagiarist, according to Augustine. Back in the days, did Turnitin make it to India? Do you have that Turnitin plagiarism detection software? Yeah. And back in the, well, they didn't have Turnitin back in those days, so they couldn't really check. All right. But let's get back to this. There's kind of two main issues here, and we'll get off of this, by the way, and we'll go on to Aristotle. Problem at the top and a problem at the bottom. We'll go to the problem at the top first. All right? Just like the forms in relation to physical things, there's a gap here. And this is why Plato will sometimes refer to this as the form of the forms. All right? But no form can be the form of the form or the good, right? And in a way, that's because the good is the source of light, which illuminates the soul so that you can see or grasp the forms that are imprinted in your soul, right? As I said, Socrates never says you can know the good. He denies you can. And the reason gets back to the analogy that's already been drawn between knowledge and vision. Because to know something is to see something, to see something you need a source of light. This is the source of light, which is why you can't see it. You would need another source of light to illuminate this. So you would need a form of the form of the forms, and so on and so on and so on. Right? This is one of Aristotle's critiques of Plato, is that the forms multiply to infinity. There has to be a form of the form, and a form of the form of the form, a form of the form of the form of the forms, and so forth. As well as a form of Socrates, a form of Socrates' hand, a form of Socrates' fingernail, a form of the form of Socrates' fingernail. This is Aristotle's critique of the whole logic of the forms. To think about it this way, hopefully, none of you have been arrested, but you've seen it on TV. They always get a suspect, they put him down, and they shine a bright light in his face. They scream at him, something like, "Where's bin Laden? You know where bin Laden is." Or, whatever they'll be screaming, right? All right? And the suspect can't see the people questioning him because there's this bright light in his face, but they obviously can see him. Now, if the suspect had a mag light, you know what a mag light is? It's a flashlight or a torch is what the English call it. Like, has 20 batteries in it. My brother used to have one. Very powerful flashlight. If he had a more powerful light that he could shine back at them and wash out the light that's shining in his face, then suddenly he would be able to see them. They wouldn't be able to see him. All right? If we had a light that was powerful enough to wash out the sun's light, we could see the sun. Not the light that comes off of the sun. We could see the sun itself. Right? You could see its surface and so forth. So that's the problem here. It's a problem of infinite regress. To know, you can know the forms but can't know the good, because if you knew the good, there'd be something else that would have to illuminate it. How would you know that? Knowledge is linked to vision, and so forth. Sorry? Yeah. So if you can't know the good, how do you know the forms are the closest thing to it? All right? So this hierarchy starts to buckle under this problem, that there isn't really a justification for saying that the forms are closest to the good. Right? Then we get down to this problem here. This is going to be the problem that Deleuze focuses on the most, this thing of simulacra. All right? What is a simulacra, or what is a simulation? At certain points, Socrates defines it as a copy of a copy of a copy, and therefore something which has very little reality. At other instances, he talks about it being a deception. And a deception is very different from a copy of a copy of a copy. So one of the in the Republic, there's a discussion of actors, and that's a very illuminating discussion. Actors are going to be banned from Plato's ideal city. And the initial discussion features an idea that is the basis of Plato's ideal city, which is that everybody has one thing they can do better than everything else. You have one skill that you do well. So if you're a thinker, you should be a philosopher, you should be a ruler. If you're good at farming, you should be a farmer. Farmers aren't going to be good at ruling. They're not going to be good at philosophy. Everybody is good at one thing. So if you end up doing whatever you end up doing, and you thought you should be doing something else, don't complain, because everybody has one thing they can do well. So, Socrates never proves that, by the way. That's just a starting point of his argument. So he starts discussing actors. The first thing Socrates says about the actors is, like everyone else, they can only do one thing well. You can be a comedic actor, you can be a dramatic actor. Nobody can do both. Right? Later on, Socrates says that actors should be barred from the city because they can do two things equally well. If we found an actor who could play many different roles equally convincingly, we would say, that's a really neat trick, but we don't let that happen in our city. Go away. Now, the second one undermines the first argument, because an actor who could play many parts equally well, in fact, it undermines the entire basis of the city. Because anybody who looks at this and says he can play a doctor, and he can play a lawyer, and he can play a peasant, and he can play a king, and he's equally convincing, well, why are each of us only one of these things? So it undermines this claim that was never proven, that was just a starting assumption. Right? Again, there's a deceptiveness to artwork which is not captured by thinking of it as a copy of a copy of a copy, right? And yeah, another example to give you. If you took a piece of paper with writing on it, page out of a book, and you photocopied it, and then you took the copy and you photocopied it, then you took that copy and you photocopied it, what happens? Sorry?
It gets blurred.
Yeah, it gets blurred, it gets faded. You can tell what a copy of a copy of a copy looks like. There's no question of it. You can see it's faded, you can see it's distorted. The thing about a good piece of artwork is it appears to be as real as the thing it copies. And this is something Lacan says about the simulacrum. The danger of the simulacrum is that it competes with the form. It presents itself as being the truth. It presents itself as something more than it is, according to Plato. And so it disrupts the whole idea of the line. Right? These things which pretend, according to Plato, simply pretend to be more than what they are. And, you know, that's the idea of a simulation or of an illusion. So the statue that you see in the distance, the figure you see in the distance that you think is a real person, but as you get closer, you realize it's a statue, or you think that you see something, but it turns out it's a reflection, right? There's an aspect of deception at play, which is more than calling it a copy of a copy of a copy. Deleuze will talk about reversing Platonism means allowing simulacra to rise to the surface, to assume their proper place, all right? And their proper place, in a way, is putting the unity of these ideas of truth into question, all right? The simulacrum is going to be, ultimately what Deleuze refers to it as, is it's a model, is it's a copy without a model, or something that puts the whole distinction between the original and the copy into question, all right? Because it appears to be the model when it really is just the copy, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It destroys the entire division. And that's the division on which this philosophical conception of truth is based. All right? Now, getting back to just a brief, why is this important for Hegel? One of the things Hegel is interested in, and this is what makes Hegel kind of the culmination of a classical philosophical tradition, is Hegel wants to ground the notion of truth. All right? And the problem with Plato tried to do that by referring to the source of truth as something transcendent. First, it's not in the physical world, you need to look inside yourself. But then it turns out that knowing the forms is supposed to be something you can grasp, but not the source that allows you to know the forms. That remains unknowable, it remains mysterious, it remains transcendent. And so, you know, this is the problem that Plato introduces, is that knowledge is constantly referring to something which is unknowable as its foundation, as its source, as its medium, and so forth. And that's going to be something that Hegel will be concerned to get rid of. When Hegel refers to the absolute and absolute knowledge, it has to be something that cannot be left unknowable and transcendent from everything we could know or could grasp. Right? And then there's the artwork, et cetera, et cetera. Are there any questions about this? Myth.
Yeah.
In Plato's thought.
Yeah, because it's of idea of being and becoming both together.
Yeah.
And because this comes from an idea of temples that they have here in India.
Right.
There are a lot of simulations of positive energies, good energies.
Yeah.
One wants to produce.
Right.
And they are shown in the real form. Say the kind of things that are placed on your head.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay.
So, in this kind of thinking of differentiation, the scale, can we place a myth somewhere? Or maybe we could place a myth in that gap that you said could never be filled?
You mean like this gap? Possibly. I mean, I don't know how to answer that directly without kind of just telling you the way Deleuze will kind of manipulate this. Because, I mean, I'll get to Aristotle in just a second. And one of Deleuze's arguments is that Platonic myth has been misunderstood because it's been treated as part of an Aristotelian project of defining a species in relation to a genus. What myth is going to be is what establishes the form, right? So it establishes the possibility of the lineage. And that's going to be why Deleuze's argument is basically that this is what Plato is trying to establish, and it's not trying to establish knowledge and truth in the same way that Aristotle does. It's a different kind of notion of difference. So the myth is what establishes the ideal type, from which you then separate what are the copies from what are the art pieces, what are the copies from what are the simulations. Yeah. Maybe. I don't know if it's the same gap. It's a foundation to fit a gap. I don't know if it's the gap that you're talking about, but maybe we're just misunderstanding each other. Yeah. Yeah. The illusions resemble the forms the most. Yeah.
Yeah, and myth and illusion are often used interchangeably.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I see. Possibly. I don't think Plato wants to use myth in that way. And that's the only thing I'd say. And that's not, Deleuze will talk about where myth appears in Plato's dialectic. It's not to establish an illusion in relation to a truth, is to establish a truth. I mean, one of the myths is in Plato's Republic is the myth of metals. You know the myth of metals? It's also called the noble lie. Right? Sometimes it's called the magnificent myth, sometimes it's called the noble lie. It gets back to this idea that everybody is born able to do certain things, not able to do other things. And the myth is that if people ask, The myth is that supposedly everyone in the city is supposed to believe is that they sprung out of the ground, and that the reason why the city is on this land and this land is their land is because they come from this land. Everyone knows that the land is settled. Someone else was kicked off to settle it. But we're going to have this myth where we came out of the land. Because we came out of the land, we're going to have metals in our soul, which will be bronze, silver, or gold. And those metals, which apparently can't be mixed, although they get mixed later on in the Republic, determine who you are. So some people are born with gold souls. They're the ones who can become philosophers. They're the ones who would rule silver and bronze. Now, the reason why some people call it the magnificent myth as opposed to the lie is that a myth can have truth to it, right? Unlike a lie. So, I mean, that is one of the things, and that is the way Plato tries to use the myth, is to establish the truth, right? Because a myth, you know, a myth is meant to be a story which maybe didn't really happen, but it expresses something that's true. Does that maybe help? Now, I mean, like, whether that's, we think of myths as art, as illusions, and that's not the way Plato would be deploying it. But yes, I mean, he's filling a gap. If nothing else, he's filling a gap in the sense that we haven't found what the model is in order to say who's the legitimate copy and who isn't, right? And so that's where we have this problem here, right? This is a copy of a copy of a copy, but if it's an illegitimate copy, it doesn't really fit on this scale, right? And Plato tries to mix it around both of those.